introduce Professor Jiawei Han today. Wonderful contribution to the summer school. Professor Han obtained his PhD from the University of Wisconsin. Well, as you see, he's currently on the faculty at the University of Illinois. He was also spent a while as faculty at Simon Fraser University. Perhaps more important is his contributions to data mining. He's a winner of both the SIGKDD Innovations Award in 2004 and the IEEE Society's Wallace McDowell Award in 2009. These are the two top awards for technical contributions in this area. He is the founding editor of ACM's Transactions on Knowledge Discovery and Databases. His students read like a who's who of this community. You are really experiencing one of the best. And I'm looking forward to the topic he is talking about. I saw a brief overview of this at the SIAM Data Mining Conference recently, where he was one of the keynote speakers. But unfortunately, in the 1 hour allowed for the keynote, he was only able to touch briefly on some of these topics. Really looking forward to hearing more details on mining heterogeneous information networks.
Okay, yeah, thanks Chris for the nice introduction. Okay, so hopefully the microphone works okay. So can you, at the end, can you hear me clearly? Okay, that's good. Like Chris just introduced me, I actually was for a long time, not too far away from the Midwest. I got my PhD in Wisconsin. Actually, my first job was in Northwestern. Chris and I, we sort of like in the same department, but not at the same time. I later went to Simon Fraser University in Canada. And then I think it's almost 10 years at UIUC. Got a pretty good team. So when Chris communicated with me, said he should come here to give a short course, I was actually wondering because I was thinking about going to Sigma. The Sigma now is right on time, actually in Athens, Greece. But finally, I decided not going there. I asked three of my students going there because we have two research papers, one demo. So they went down there. They are enjoying Athens, okay. So I actually just drove yesterday down here. It's pretty close. Anytime you are interested in visiting UIUC, it's pleasant, 90 minutes drive, you can go down there, okay. So it's the two campuses are really, really very close. Okay. So the talk I'm going to give is on mining heterogeneous information networks. The reason I give this a very interesting reason actually is we got a pretty big grants from U.S. Army Research Lab. They asked us to set up an academic research center for information networks. It's a pretty big grant, of course, not only shared by UIUC and also with IBM Research, with UC Santa Barbara, City University of New York, plus quite a few other individuals from CMU, Northwestern University, Michigan, and Palo Alto Research Park. So the total funding actually is almost $17 million. So it's a pretty big amount of money for 5 years research. Since I'm leading this information networks, this is the second year. We got lots of results I also want to share with you. That's the reason you can see we actually wrote down a lot of acknowledgments. Actually, currently, for Officer Murray Grant, I also share in the same project team as Chris, Professor Clifton. So that's the reason we got lots of connections. So the thing I'm going to discuss, essentially the first thing is why we want to do data mining with heterogeneous information networks. Then I'm going to go through a few we say algorithms or system prototypes we have been developing or we have been published. So these several things I think is pretty excited. Of course, my team is quite big. Currently, I have almost 20 PhD students. So they are very selective. They're working really hard. Every year we generate lots of papers. It's impossible to, within 2 hours, I can give you all the introduction. Even just 1 year's work is almost impossible. Okay. So I'm going to give you quite a few very exciting things related to information networks. That's the reason I've selected these several interesting algorithms. And hopefully, after you listening, all these things, you got excited. I actually got one researcher yesterday communicate with me from Australia. He actually said he listened to my talk on one of the algorithms, which is rank class, the first one. He got very excited. He actually used the similar idea, get into Medline, which is PubMed. You probably know the medical publications. The interesting thing is he wants to see without seeing doctor, okay? He just wants to do data mining on the publications of medical science to see what disease, okay, should have what kind of treatment, okay? And he says it doesn't mean he wants to substitute medical doctor, just to say for any medical doctor, get one disease, see all the different kinds of treatment and rank them. It is very hard, even for a very well-trained medical doctor. So he shows he can do something quite interesting. So the first thing I probably want to introduce you is why mining with heterogeneous information network. Before I giving you this one, I want to first give a distinction between homogeneous versus heterogeneous networks. The first thing is, what is information network? Okay, I think most people heard social network. I believe it. Probably everybody heard of it. The reason is very obvious. Not only you got a movie or on social networks, I think people know that. If you go to Facebook, last month, right after the talk at SIME Data Mining Conference, the second day, I have to leave because I was due to give a talk in Facebook. So actually, it was my previous student invited me. I went down there. It was very interesting because, the CEO, Mark, actually, it's a glass door. Everybody can see him during the working hours. And everybody can see everybody else. So it's a very interesting environment. Even, you get a so huge platform, it's hundreds or even thousand people, and everybody can see each other. It's a really, well connected. What is information network? Information network actually is a little more general considering social network. Social networks, people linking with people. You think about, if you get into Facebook or LinkedIn, You quite often you may receive emails say who and who want to build a connection with you. You may look at the profile or you know the person. You just say yes. Okay, then you build the connections. This network essentially is all the people connected with people. But what is information network? Information network is information connected with information. Okay, and you actually can think social network is just part of information network because people, you can think is entity, okay? Connecting with other people is another entity, just the same kind of entity, they are people, so you're connected, okay? But information network is, people can connect with information as well. For example, if you write a paper, you publish paper in some conference, essentially, you as an author, okay, you can connect with the paper because you wrote it, okay? And the paper was published in a conference, you connected with conference, you use certain keywords in your title or in your abstract, suppose it's collected by PubMed, those things, you are connected with those keywords as well, right? So essentially, what we call information network is any entity connect with other entities, we form a huge, gigantic network. We call this as information network. Okay. Then what is homogeneous versus heterogeneous? Homogeneous means all are same kind of entity, like people. Okay. Then you connect each other, this Facebook like this, people connect with people, this homogeneous. Okay. Of course, every person may have different features, different properties. They can vary quite a lot, but essentially the major link are the same kind of entity. Okay. And if you look at a page rank, for example, you say page connected with pages. They are all web pages, they connect each other. You can think this is homogeneous. Okay. But what is heterogeneous ones? Heterogeneous one means you're connecting to different kinds or different types of information. For example, if you publish papers, you connect with paper. Paper is not a person, okay? So you get a person connected with paper, the paper connected with conference, or paper connects with keywords. They are all different kinds. So we call this different kinds of connection, it's called multi-typed heterogeneous networks. But on the other hand, our study more confined to relative structure. So-called relative structure means if you know this is a person, you know this is a paper, okay? And you got this entity, say this entity actually is a paper, so you belong to the type of paper. So people, you can say authors, connected with papers, okay? This are structure. Structure means the type is clear. Okay. Actually, this kind of network almost anywhere. Okay. I give you one example, like a medical network. You got patients, doctors, even they are all people. Okay. But the patients and doctors may play very different roles. Okay. So you can connect with patients, but usually you probably don't even want like to connect with patients unless you want to share information to see how to handle it. Okay. But in many cases, you do connect with doctors, doctor connect with nurses, okay? So those are different kinds of people. Even they have connections to all people, but they play different roles. In that sense, we also think they are heterogeneous, okay? Of course, you may even argue with me, you say web pages, some are home pages, some are, you know, like decoration pages or ads. I can partition them into different kinds. I link them together. Yes, if you really partition them into multiple types, you link them together as typed structured, all the algorithm, all the benefits we studied, you will get. Okay, so later you will see that. So that's exactly why people just in PubMed, they actually using all the different keywords, different disease, they connect together, they can get a benefit. Okay. Then another argument we just say is, just because we use somewhat structured, we got lots of benefit comparing to unstructured, okay? Some people claim they are doing heterogeneous information network, but they don't distinguish any type. They just say anything can connect to anything. You probably look at a word net, okay? If you know word net, you get any word linked to any word. So you say, oh, all the words are different. They have meanings. Okay, they all link together, you form a heterogeneous information network. Actually, this kind of network will be very hard, you know, to be even quite useful. The reason is just because they are not typed, they can be anything, they connect anything, the information you got. The link are different types, you cannot distinguish them. The objects are different types, so you can hardly get benefit, okay? That's the reason we enforce ourselves to study the structured. If you are handling, for example, natural languages, okay, you say, I got probably in, thank you, Maraj, okay, yeah, okay. So if you study natural languages, you do parsing, you say, I know actually where, when, what, how, who, you know. Once I distinguish them, I know clearly this is about a person. This is about object, this is about a location. I link them together. Actually, you really got this somewhat structured network. Okay, many things we discuss here can be used. So I give you, graphically, I give you some distinction. Probably it's very easy to see. Is the first thing, I keep using this DBRP, is computer science bibliographic network, okay? Essentially, you get all the authors, papers, conferences connected. That one, if you project them, you say, now I'm not going to study how the author link with papers. I just say, who are the co-authors? How are they linked together? I can project to get a co-author network. This is a real co-author network we extracted. That's very easy. You probably can see, actually, this year, the KDD conference chair is Prof. Smith. I put him in the middle. Actually, this is not this year. Actually, this many years ago, I put him in the middle to study this. You actually can see the links, okay. But the other one, I got a simple one, the imaginary one. It's not quite real because this one is quite real. This one is, I just show you, these are several conferences, like this is conference author network. These are the conference, these are the authors, okay. Conference link with authors by, for example, if you attend a conference, of course you can bear a link. But if you author some paper published in some conferences, you can bear a link. This one essentially is author published in certain conferences will bear links, okay. But what I probably should say is this network actually can be generated from some kind of network like this, okay. For example, you got the DBRP database, you got an author, you had for this particular paper, you got three authors linked to this paper. Simply say these three are co-authors. Then by projecting, ignore the paper, you just build a co-author network, you get this one. So you can say the homogeneous network essentially were derived from the heterogeneous one. Heterogeneous one contain more information, more complete information, comparing to the co-author network, the heterogeneous one, the homogeneous one. Then I'm going to show you, just taking this DBRP database, okay, I'm going to show you something magic. You probably can hardly imagine things can be done, but it can actually be done, you know, using the data mining in this heterogeneous information networks. Okay. If you published or you searched the DBRP database, you know almost everybody, if you publish something in a worthy conference workshop, unless they think this conference workshop is so tiny, they do not even think it was listed. Otherwise, it should be collected there, okay, for computer science. And for this, currently, this number actually is a little outdated, but you probably can still use it. Currently, it's a little over 1.5 million records, okay? And with 0.7 million, because remember, one paper can be co-authored by many authors. So that's the reason, actually, the author is not too small, because some author can publish many papers, but you know, some people only got one or two. But that's 700,000 authors and 5,000 conferences or some journals, okay. So this database is not too big, because if you look at PubMed is about 10 times bigger than DBRP. Okay, they have about 15 million entries. Okay, this one is 1.5 million entries. The medical science is far bigger, right? So for this one, you probably want to say, what kind of information I can get? Of course, you can get is who published which papers in which conferences. You can easily get this. But some other information you want to get, actually, it's not that easy. I'm going to show you some interesting things. The first thing is, you know, how are CS research forums structured? That means, you look at so many papers, so many authors, so many conferences. Can you find a cluster, say, this actually is the database conference and database authors. This actually is AI. This is more like you know, machine learning or computer architecture. Can you automatically get this? Okay. Can you know this conference? For example, each CHI actually is an AI conference. Or like you know, ICD is a database conference. Can you know that? Can you know that this automatically, even you are not in the field? Okay, so that could be one interesting question you may want to know. Another is, who are the leading researchers on web search? Okay, so that may not be that easy to answer. Okay, so you type web search, they will rank who are the leading ones, who are not. So, you know, can we do that? That may not be that easy, right? The third one is, how do the authors of this subfield collaborate and evolve? I mean, can you find, you know, certain author they originally published in this subfield, later they change it? I actually remember I got one, we invited one professor who actually was working in bioinformatics. But interestingly, you know, everybody in the department knows he's a top researcher in robotics, okay? And when he came here, he talked all things on bioinformatics, bioinformaticians really got excited. But the people actually thinking whether this is the same person, right? Because he was a very big guru on robotics. Everybody knows him, okay? So that of course, he trained himself, changed the field. It evolves. Another thing is I just show you how many way ones in DBRP. Remember this co-author like John Smith, this is a popular name, like this way one is a very popular Chinese name. And there are lots of people who actually share exactly the same last name, same first name, and they share the same entry, okay? So can we distinguish them, okay, automatically? And you probably know who is search brand. How many people know that? Yeah, I think at least half, because if you know PageRank, you know Google, you should know him, because he's the first author of PageRank paper, and who is a co-founder and CEO, or I do not know whether it's the CEO or not now. But anyway, he's a co-founder, one of the three co-founders of Google, okay. But he was a PhD student, so in Stanford University, in DBRP, they never label you were from Stanford, okay. So how could you know who is his advisor, okay? Can you know it automatically, okay? So that's also pretty interesting. And another thing is, can you predict which topics Christos Philosophus will work on, okay? This one actually was Christos Philosophus raised question to me, okay? It's the last year I gave a keynote speech in Spain, Barcelona, Spain. It's a ECMR PKDD conference. They asked me to give a keynote speech. Christos was sitting right there. And I list a bunch of them. I did not list the last one. Then he challenged me. He said, can you predict which paper I'm going to write next year? Okay. Which I said, I even do not know what paper I'm going to write next year. Right? But we did have some interesting prediction, you probably can see. Especially my student actually predicted who you are going to co-author with. Surprisingly, actually, her prediction was quite accurate. She was using, you know, year data from 1996 to 2001, then predicted from 2002 to 2009 who I'm going to co-author with. And it's quite interesting to see the result. So the interesting thing is, with this just a plain publication entry, even without abstract, the only thing you have is the title, okay? And there's no citation information even, okay, in DBRP. You do not know which paper cite which. But how could you get all these kind of things out? Okay, that's not an easy question, especially we say you cannot look at any other sources. You cannot look at the web, you cannot even search in the database or using Google. That's the only data you got, okay? So, that's the power. That's the power of information network we are going to explore. Okay. So now I'm going to show you a bunch of very interesting algorithms. I probably first show you the one I got most excited one is rank class. Okay. So that's the one the student actually, if you say, because this lecture actually was invited by the Department of Statistics. Okay. I got the student. She got double major from Beijing University. She got one major is computer science, the other one is statistics, okay? That's exactly the reason I found her immediately. I recruit her to my group, okay? And she did something really magic. I think statistics combined with computer science, something magic may come out, okay? So we probably can look at this. The first interesting thing is ranking and clustering. I think probably everybody knows these two functions. You use it all the time. Okay. Ranking, I think, probably is most prominent in the last 10 years. If you say, what is the most or biggest invention? Actually, some people even say, I know what you're going to say, it's PageRank or something related to Google, okay? Which is very true, because before Google came, okay, when we met in computer science conference, you know what's the most important thing? We want to get everybody's name card. Why name card so important? Because it contains URL, okay? Without URL, it's very hard to find people. Nowadays, nobody even wants name card. Give me name card, say, I just know your name, I type Google, I'll get you, okay? That time, there were no such thing, okay? How do you get? You probably know there's some Gopher or some, you know, there are lots of old software. But the very important thing is, if you type a name, okay, suppose you type Christos Falousas, if you type that even now, the Google will say, 40,000 entries found, okay? Which could be exciting or could be dooming, okay? If those pages were not ranked, if you type Christos Falousas, you got 40,000. You probably say, my gosh, how can I find him in 40,000 pages? Okay, maybe his homepage is right in the middle, okay? How could you get it? It takes days, right? So if there's no ranking, nobody even wants to use it, because the matching, the simple matching searching using inverted index without ranking is nothing beneficial, right? You get 40,000 words, you say, I just quit, okay? But nowadays, you say, I don't need URL, I just type Christos Falousas, you know, or even something close, I actually got him right away, okay? So that's the power of ranking, okay? And why we want to do clustering, okay? Of course, you may say, oh, if you get so many things, for example, you get so many papers, you want to cluster papers. This actually is a machine learning paper on the read. So that's kind of power of clustering, right? You really want something similar, you want to get them together. But the thing is, these two functions in the past, they all work individually. Individually in the sense, you know, people doing ranking say, you give me a bunch of things, I rank them, okay? People doing clustering say, you give me a group of things, I partition them into different groups. But the key is, in reality, you give me a bunch of things. Suppose I give you 10,000 papers, okay? You say, I rank those papers, it's almost impossible. How you rank these 10,000 papers, okay? Then you say, I cluster those papers, and sometimes you can do clustering reading where, but sometimes it's hard, okay? Because some paper actually cross the border. But the interesting thing is, if you can do clustering ranking together, actually these two functions may even help each other, okay? So that's thinking we were thinking about why we do this clustering and ranking together. The reason is obviously, if you can cluster things, you can rank them better, right? You say this is paper all in the same class, okay? These are all web search. So I can rank them who probably should rank high. But the interesting thing is also, if you get a good ranking, you probably say, take this highly regarded things, I cluster them surrounding it. Probably I can also find good clusters, right? So you're thinking about researchers. Suppose people in database all know like Jim Gray or Mike Stonebaker, those are the first two. One did the first relational database system at IBM, System R, the other one did in Berkeley, Ingress, so they are highly regarded. If you take this two, put it there, you say cluster the people surrounding it, you probably can get a very good database cluster, right? So ranking and clustering somehow should be helping each other. Now I'm going to show you the concrete example. We just run it. We show, you know, without clustering, without ranking, actually things cannot do well. Instead of doing many other things, so we just pick up 10 database data mining conference, just those conference names, and 10 computer architecture and hardware. You know these two are pretty hard, pretty widely separated, okay? But if we mix them up, we say rank them. Okay, what do you get? If you mix them up, you rank them. The first thing you look at, this is our ranking. The people, I probably should use some statistic example, but my knowledge on statistics conference actually is quite minimal. Journals, I know a few. So these are the computer architecture conference. The last three actually database conferences. You probably look at this, 20 conferences actually is somehow dominated by the computer architecture conference. So probably with the computer architecture, you get more researchers, a little more, you know, bigger conferences, or somehow they swamped, okay, the database field. Not only on the conference names, but also on the authors. If you look at the authors, I actually almost know nobody because I'm not working in computer architecture and hardware. The only person I checked I know actually was Jason Kong, not because he was a famous computer architect, but he actually was a department head of UCLA, and he graduated from UIC. That's the reason I know him. Okay, otherwise, I or even have no knowledge of any of them. But if we do rank and cluster together, we partition them in different clusters, we just said K is two, just like, you know, two clusters, we actually get a very good database cluster and also ranking. And also for the authors, the ranking is also quite respected. Okay? So you see the rank and class, if you do clustering and ranking together, somehow it will help each other. Okay. So then we got a philosophy. We say we are not going to just say ranking is ranking, clustering is clustering. We put this ranking and clustering in the same loop. Okay. Then we'll see what things will happen. Okay. What's a philosophy? Okay. You probably, everybody knows, I believe, you know, in this audience, everybody will know what is clustering. Okay. And everybody probably knows what is EM, what is K-means. Okay. But no matter what clustering algorithm we are using, so there's one general principle. The principle is, you take a lot of objects, you treat every object have the same weight, okay? Simply says, you get 1,000 authors, you say every author is equal, okay? Then I do clustering. I get 10 clusters, they belong to them, 10 different fields. But in reality, even you look at authors, you know they are not equal, okay? Nothing is absolutely equal. You probably, I just give you the Jim Gray or Mike Stonebreaker. These are two database gurus, okay? If I put, say, Mike Stonebreaker into AI, and he actually never published any paper or co-authored with anybody in AI, I believe. He's very, very pure, like database guy. If I put him in the wrong cluster, okay, many things may change. You probably know, because he got lots of co-authors, he used lots of, you know, jargons or keywords, actually all these belongs to the database field. If I put this guy into a wrong cluster, many things may change. The quality of your clustering could be very bad, okay? But if I put, say, the first year a student, computer science student from Purdue, okay, suppose he happened published one paper in a database or in AI conference, I put him in the wrong cluster. Do you think something will happen? Probably nothing will happen because he was so young. You know, you put it into any cluster, you won't change the cluster. Okay, so people are not quite equal. The authors are not equal. Okay, if they are not equal, why our clustering algorithm treat them equally? Okay, so that's a simple question. Okay, that question probably is can we design an algorithm and say, treat Mike Stonebreaker has much more weight than this first year PhD student? Okay, that's possible, right? Why we don't do that? Okay, so that one, you know, push us to think, why we have to treat every object in clustering equally? But how do you treat them differently? Ranking, right? Why we don't rank them? Okay, if we rank them, no, Mike Stonebreaker ranked higher or much higher than the student, probably we can treat Mike Stonebreaker heavier weight than the student. Then things may happen, maybe happen in a better direction, okay? So that's general philosophy. That simply says, if we can get a bunch of things, we rank something heavier, okay? Then when we do clustering, we probably take those heavier things, weights more, we put to those centers, say big, you know, database guru, big AI guru, big, you know, information retriever guru, we put them at the center, then we start a clustering, probably we'll do something better. Okay. If we do something better, what about we come back and rank again? Okay. Then even at the very beginning, our rank may be wrong. Okay, maybe not so accurate. But once we partition them into different clusters, we actually can find this guy, like Mike Stonebreaker, ranks so high, not so high in some other field, just in one field, in the database field. Okay, then things become even clearer. You know, we never say he's ranked high in AI. Okay, then things will become even better. So that's the philosophy. We are thinking we have to change our clustering algorithm. We are not doing plain equal class. We are doing rank class. Okay, that's the algorithm we got the name called rank class. Okay, ranking and clustering working together. Okay. So with this idea, now we are thinking is we want integrate them together, and at every iteration, we want reclustering and re-ranking. Okay. Why we have to reclustering and re-ranking? The reason is the last iteration, we actually got a little better ranking thing, and we use this ranking, we do a little better clustering, and we got a better clustering, we know who, where he is, we can do better ranking again, so we can turn it around, okay? So that's the general philosophy. Actually, I give you the algorithm, you'll probably say, oh, this is, if you know EM algorithm, you'll say this actually is not too far away from EM, which is true, okay? But actually this, you know, it's pretty interesting. You probably see that something inside is rather different, okay? The first thing is when you initialize, this is like EM or even you're thinking K-means, at the very beginning, you can even partition them randomly. If you don't know them, if you give me a K, okay, I just randomly partition things into K clusters, okay? But remember, we are handling heterogeneous information network. When we partition them, we partition actually all the things they are linked, okay? We partition authors, in the meantime, we also partition keywords, conferences, all these partitioning together. At this point, at the rank class, the first stage, first study, we only did a bipartite. Bipartite means we only study authors and conferences, these two, okay? But even you, these two, you form a network. When you rank, when you cluster conferences, you sort of cluster authors, they are linked, okay? Obviously, things linked closer, you will cluster them closer, tighter. So you use the link as some kind of weight you can do clustering. Okay? Then we do ranking. But for this ranking, I probably want to give you a little grain of salt, is ranking can be done in a different way. Later I'm going to show you the ranking. You may input your ranking criteria into it, okay? But anyway, you use some kind of ranking function. You can rank those objects in different clusters. Then you can generate measure space. Essentially, is you can say, oh, once I start ranking them, this particular object in this cluster ranked is somewhat higher than the other cluster. Remember, this is soft clustering. Everything, even Mike Stonebreaker at the beginning or even at the end, is not 100% pure in one cluster. He may got something a little like in, say, information retriever or something. He may get a little. So he may say 99% belong to database, 1% belong to information retrieval. It's fine, okay? And after this, we adjust the cluster, we repeat the step. That means we adjust the cluster, then we repeat it again. If you see, you know k-means, you say, I assign this object into right down into the other cluster, then I redo, recompute the cluster center, okay? So EM, that's the same thing. So this one essentially is kind of EM because it's soft clustering, okay? But remember, you put ranking things inside, okay? And in the network, when you really do this, okay, in the network, what you do is, because it's a heterogeneous information network, you got a heterogeneous, you know, information matrix. Okay. For example, if you say I assign X, the type X is a conference, Y is for author, okay, you got X, 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 Y, Y, X, and Y, Y, this kind of partitioned matrix. Okay. It simply says this, X, X means how the conference is linked. At the very beginning, you don't know. You actually say, initially, none of the conference is linked. Okay. So all the venues, conferences, X, X is empty. Okay, they are all yours. But remember, when this Y, this author, start publishing in some conference, then X, Y, and Y, X is initial function. They are linked. Okay, because you publish in this conference, you link to this conference. Okay. Y, Y at the very beginning is not empty because you may have co-authors. They publish, you co-author five papers with this guy, you have, you know, link weighted five in this matrix. So that means these are not empty, this is empty, but remember this is the initial one. Later you will see the conference actually are linked. Okay. Then we come down to the ranking. Okay. Actually, ranking can be done in many different ways. For example, even when you try to rank universities, you know, all different fields, you probably see people all have different views. Okay. The different views simply say they have different ranking criteria. This actually is quite normal. We explore two criteria. One we call simple ranking, another we call authoritative ranking. Simple ranking is very simple. If you publish more papers, you rank high. Okay. If this conference publishes more papers, the conference rank high. Okay. That's initially, that's a simple ranking. But this may not be quite fair. The reason is this, okay, obviously in academic field, everybody knows, okay, the conferences actually rank very differently. They have different grading or different, you know, reputation. If you, suppose one professor, okay, submit the paper to a top conference, got rejected. The professor may get mad, say, I set up my own conference, okay. Every of my student paper we got published there, okay, then I got 100 papers a year, okay. So you think this is a good researcher? So you probably say, oh, that must be a bogus conference, right? So that's true. Actually, you probably heard even I think MIT wrote an automatic paper generator using some randomized algorithm because somebody keep bugging them sending papers. So they think this guy is of no quality. They send some automated, generated, meaningless paper, but grammarly definitely right, and even outlook is right, okay. You send it down there, the paper got accepted, okay. So then even this become a very embarrassing news for this conference because I don't believe the paper even got reviewed. They probably do not understand anything inside, but they just take it. So this even become a news and published in New York Times, I was told. So that's simply says that there are some bogus conferences, right? So, but how can you judge? Okay. The interesting thing people can easily judge this could be this. You say, you set up your own conference, okay? You got the papers. The only thing I really can easily judge you is whether other famous researcher will join you, okay? It simply says when you publish in a bogus conference, you ask other people to send papers. They look at it and say, no, I definitely won't. It damaged my reputation, right? Why I send there, okay? So that's the reason when we set up a ranking rule, we think we need authority ranking. Authority ranking, the first rule probably is quite easy. Say highly ranked author publishing many papers in highly ranked conferences. Okay, so probably you will take this. The problem you immediately will ask, what is highly ranked conference? Okay. So the highly ranked conference, we actually said a highly ranked conference attract many papers from many highly ranked authors. You will see there are double many, right? Not only get many papers, but also many highly ranked authors. Okay. If the other highly ranked author would not like to join you, simply say there could be some problem of your conference, right? So the third rule is also we find that sometimes it's useful because the rank of author is enhanced if he or she co-author with many authors, especially with many highly ranked authors. Okay, that probably you would recognize because suppose you are a first year PhD student in Stanford University. And how could you rank a little higher than some other university in some other countries? Okay. The interesting thing is you probably say, oh, I co-authored a paper with Michael Jordan. Okay, then you definitely become the glory, right? So you can say it. The reason, obviously, is you co-author with highly ranked authors, you yourself think you are reputed, right? So we code this one into this rule 3. Of course, you may hate this rule. You can somehow, you know, we actually use a slide bar. You can adjust it. But anyway, we take this as a rule. We code all these 3 rules into matrix form, which is pretty simple. It's just a matrix, addition. You just add those values. You actually can see this is this is author. If author is how it's ranked, it's actually ranked based on how many papers you publish in the highly ranked conferences, right? This is conference rank. And a conference actually is rank. You look at the authors and look at the authors rank. You add those authors. This one actually we use a slide bar. Okay, this is alpha and 1 minus alpha is the parameter you can do adjustment. Do adjustment simply says sometimes you want to put more attention on the conferences. Sometimes you want to put more attention on the co-authors. It really depends on how do you like them. You can adjust them. Okay. So once we put this, the interesting thing actually happens. We look at, for a computer, anybody write program, you want to see the execution process. We actually also want to see if we use that algorithm, put this ranking rule there, what is happening? Okay. So we still use the same data sets. We got 20 conferences, 10 from database and data mining, 10 from computer architecture and hardware. We mix them up, okay? We say we just use, okay, there's no citation information, remember. We just use those conferences and authors. Just use these 2 pieces of information, but they are linked, okay? Then we put them inside, we start using our rank class algorithm to turn it around, okay? You actually can see initially things are all mixed up. Okay, these are the ranking, these are the conference. Okay, initially mixed up, it doesn't mean they do not separate anything at all, because if you publish more papers, you still get a little higher ranked. So initially there are still some distinction on the ranking, but it's very vague. Okay, and the clustering, they all group together. You cannot distinguish computer architecture cluster and database cluster, because initially who knows which name is architecture, name is conference, is computer architecture. So then we start using those links, using these ranking rules and doing rank class. You know, after 1 iteration, 2 iteration, actually this is less than 10 iterations, things get very stable, so we stop, okay. And then we see actually these 2, you can see this is a cluster of database data mining. This is computer hardware and computer architecture. The ranking in these 2 groups are well separated. You actually can see this part ranked high in this green line, rank pretty low in this region, but the blue line actually ranked high in this region. Okay, so that means the ranking are highly separated. That means you rank high in database, unlikely you rank high in hardware, okay, or vice versa. And the cluster also become very clear. You can see the red one and the green one, they are well separated. Simply says they are different clusters, because they actually do, the people publishing database barely publishing computer hardware, okay. And with this, we actually just did a very tiny, adjustment. We say adjust different k's. When we set a k, for example, 15, we take DBRP, the database, we got a 20,000 conference, 2,000 conference, 20,000 authors from these many years. We take this, we just say K is 15. Of course, 15 is too wide. We just give you a bunch of them. Okay, you probably see the first thing is the cluster is quite clear for those conferences. You look at this is the IR-like conference. This is the AI-like conference, theory-like conferences, computer network and the database. They are actually well separated. The conference, if you were in certain field, you probably know it, they are in this field. And the ranking actually was not bad if you look at it because there's no citation information. You look at the ranking, for example, if you were in computer theory, look at it, SODA, Stock, Fox, probably those are the top three conferences anyway. Okay, and SIGIR, because our cluster actually, because we only set up 15, multimedia and SIGIR is actually in the same cluster, but you'll probably see these are also pretty good clusters, right? So then you may say, you got 20,000 authors, you know, 2,000, you know, all these different things, so many, especially you got 15 million papers in PubMed, how slow you will run. Actually, this algorithm is very fast, if you think about this. The reason is this, okay, every time, suppose we set K is 15, every time you get 15 centers, okay, for every object, when you try to compare, you want to give a new weight, you compare with the center, okay? The center is just 15, it's a constant, okay? K is a constant, it's usually a small constant. Then every time you do all the computation with this K cluster centers, that computation is U versus a small constant, okay? Every object versus small constant, so essentially, you look at the ranking, it's big OE. Okay, E is number of edges. And you look at clustering and a mixed model computation, all of these is sort of linear to the number of edges. Okay. And in the real life, for example, in computer science publications, who got the most papers? I probably know Philip Yu got probably the most papers, maybe 600 papers. 600 is a big number, but it's still a constant, right? So to that extent, even you say everybody published 600 papers, your time, that means every node may have 600 edges. That E and N, the number of nodes, actually still is a small constant. So it's linear to number of edges, it's almost linear to number of nodes. So it's pretty, cheap algorithm. Especially if you compare some network algorithm, like a very popular one called SimRank, was developed, it's a ranking, kind of a similarity ranking, kind of a clustering algorithm. And that algorithm actually, one iteration, okay, cost, actually you think about it, what's the idea of SimRank is this, okay. You want to look at these two objects, how similar they are, you look at the connections, okay, their neighbors, how similar their neighbors are. And look at their neighbors, how similar of them. For each one, you look at their neighbors, okay? So you think about this. When you start comparing how many neighbors you have, how many neighbors, the neighbors, neighbors you have, okay, that one itself, the comparison is definitely quadratic, right? It's just comparing two objects, you got a quadratic on your whole links. That's terrible, okay? So that's the reason we say you get the whole thing, it's still quite cheap. That's the first time we got excited. We said this rank class actually is quite interesting because you do not know anything. You can cluster them, you can rank them just based on the links. Okay. Then we would say, what about we do not only two objects, this bipartite network, we do a more general network. Okay. Then we found the general network in DBRP can be modeled using a star network schema. What is star network schema? If you were in database field, you probably know in data warehouse, there's one called star schema. You take the center, you look at all its links, all the other object link with the center, actually form like a star, like the center is a big one, it's like a sun, and then you got a small things surrounding it. Okay, so this actually is the same here, you look at it. This is a research paper. This is one type. The research paper will have links to at least three things. You can see one is linked to venue, the conference where it's published. One is linked to author who wrote it. One is linked to term and what terms contain in the title. Remember, in DBRP, we do not have much information. We only have paper title information. Okay. Then you'll probably see, with this kind of network, if you look at the types, there's only four types. One is in the center, the other is surrounding it. That's why we call this one star schema. Schema means types. So you look at the type description. If you study database system, you know what is schema. Okay. Now, the interesting thing is, what about we do rank and the clustering together for the star network? Okay. The interesting thing is, once we do this, we partition them into different cluster. Okay. For example, this one is a database cluster, this is a hardware cluster, this is a theory cluster. We partition into them different clusters. These are still in the same schema. Okay. The interesting thing is, you decompose this into this. The still paper, venue, author, title, this kind of schema, because every paper still link with the same thing, right? This is more like people in bioinformatics study DNA. Okay. You take this person, okay, how can you recognize a criminal? Okay. Nowadays, you know, with DNA technology, it's reasonably easy and precise. The reason is, no matter this person you see the picture or not, you get a piece of hair or some, you know, thing, you actually can go inside and look at DNA structure. They have the same structure as your other components. Okay. So that's the same thing. We partition them, they still keep the same structure. So with this idea, we work out a new algorithm, which actually is a rank class extension from the bipartite network to the star schema network. We call net class. That means a network-based clustering. Okay. And for this net class, essentially is we have a center type, then we have some surrounding types. Okay. And then we, once we do the clustering, we actually partition them into different clusters. We get a network cluster. And then we found actually many, many examples you got is the same thing. Actually, the student, she actually put to my homepage, look at this. These are the papers. You know, like you got a research paper. Every paper have this net, this one. But if you look at delicious, okay, you probably play with delicious. You probably see you have tagging events, you have a user, you have a website, you have tags. Okay, this is also a star network. And some people may know IMDb if you want to download some movie, you know, watch it or get more information or comments or something. You probably see the movie, you may have movie, you have a director, you have actor, you have title, you have plots, or you may even have a rating and comments or something. So you actually, the movie may also form a star network. So it's very popular, okay. Then I'm going to show you this one. You say, this is really boring because you only give me numbers. It doesn't make sense anymore. Actually, this one is a real computer output, but it does make sense if you watch it carefully because we color it, okay. What's the magic of this color? If you know the conference, okay, remember this is the result. We after a certain number of iterations, you got a ranking, you get a clustering, you actually will see here these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 are the 5 clusters. Okay. We actually take a subset. The subset is database, data mining, information retrieval, and AI. We take these 5 subsets. Okay. 5 years. And the other one, the fifth one is miscellaneous, is others or something. We take these 5 as 5 clusters, then we start turning. That means K is 5. We take just this subset because we know this subset quite well. So we take this, we say clustering it and ranking it. You see what's the result you'll get? The first interesting thing is everybody knows triple AI is in AI, okay? Then you look at where is the red one, the third column, red one. Then you look at the third column, okay. Third column is bigger. You look at those third column, 1, 2, 3. This is triple AI, CBPR, ECML, ICML, each guy. These are AI conference. They're shining on the third column, okay. You look at the first column, EDBT, ICD, TOTS, Sigma, VRDB, those are pure database conference. They're shining on the first column, okay? So you actually can see after turning around, the clustering become very clear for those conferences. It may not make sense to somebody like in statistics. That's exactly, if you came as a statistician, you came to computer science, you don't know any conference, click the button, you know everything. That's great, okay? Like people from Mars even can click the same button, right? Now we look at the database cluster in a little more detail, see what we'll get, okay? Actually, if you know database, or even you don't know it, you probably will find it does make a lot of sense, because some people say, how do you know the tag? How do you know this database? I say, there's no magic. You just look at the keywords. What are the top keywords? Top keywords are database, databases, system, data, query, management, object, relational, processing, distributed XML. Those are the very, very typical database terms. Those are the topics they're working on, okay? So those top-ranked keywords clearly distinguish this is a database field, because that's the database systems, right? There's nothing to override this part, okay? And you look at these are the top conferences, these are top authors, so they are very, very well done, okay? We actually go down even lower. We want to, within database, we want to get more clusters. We found one is XML, XQuery, because the top keywords would say XML, XQuery. We got a bunch of people. The interesting thing is I first showed this one in Pisa, Italy, in 2008, ICDM conference. The interesting is ICDM is a pure data mining conference. They invite a database person called Serge Abitbol, give a keynote speech. Lots of people from other countries look at this guy and say, where did this guy come from? I never heard of it. And when he got a discussion on this XML data mining, they got excited. So they invited a probably good person. Actually, this person was ranked number one, okay? If you do not know it, you just look at it. He's ranked number one, XML, XQuery. So that's why they invite him, right? And this is run class. This is the first algorithm. Then we get into another one. I just changed. If you look at this, you see, did you get a typo? Okay. Actually, it's not really a typo. It's just from class to class. It's clustering become classification. Okay. I think people in statistic field probably play this tool most. Either you do clustering or do classification. Okay. So we look at this run class, okay. And this one, actually, this is the intentions. Another girl is called Ming Ji. She actually just came later. It's when she joined us, we already got this run cluster algorithm. Then she was interested in classification, okay. Then got an algorithm in a similar philosophy, but working on the classification. And he wanted to make sure, you know, he got something similar. That's why I get a very similar name, okay? So actually the general philosophy is this. What Yizhou Sen was doing clustering. Assume you do not have knowledge, okay? But many people say, I do. I know actually Triple AI is one of the top AI conferences, and Sigma is one of the top database conferences. I know it, why don't allow me to say it, okay? So it's true, if you know something you put in, actually you can get something even better, okay? That's the reason we say we want to use training, okay? Rank class algorithm have no training. It simply says, you give me a K, you give me a bunch of ranking rules. You know, click the button, it comes, okay? But what about we have training? We have class labels, okay? Can we do something better? Or can we do something quite smart? So that's the reason, actually, when Ming Ji came, she actually worked out two papers. This one, I should not to say sub, it's already taken. It's in KDD 2011. So we got GNet mine, and the other algorithm called rank class is in KDD. Actually, it's next month. This is still June. It's in early August in San Diego. She's going to go there, present the paper on rank class, okay. The GNet mind, the general philosophy is this, okay? This one does not really using ranking, but using heterogeneous networks. That means people doing classification is, you give me class label, okay? Then I can use features, okay? Certain feature, you can do feature selection, whatever. You can get a good classification model, okay? But with network as a feature, with the link as a feature, people actually work out a new link-based classification algorithm. What she did for this one, this GNet mine, actually was just saying, I'm not just taking network, I'm taking heterogeneous type network. That means I actually partition the paper into this is the paper, this is a conference, this is the author, this is the keywords. I take the typed network, I redo the training and the classification, and she shows actually this GNet mine using network to do mining. Actually, the typed network is far better. Okay. Then that's last year's. Then this year, she was discussing with me. She says she wants to use Ijo's idea, rank them. Okay. The similar philosophy is the objects in classification should be treated differently. Okay. Then we'll see how we can make it things even better. Okay. Now, I probably give you a little philosophy on this rank class because I really like this algorithm. The idea is pretty simple. You can think it's very straightforward. Follow the same philosophy is the objects in classification should be treated differently, should be weighted differently. Okay, you probably agree with this already. Okay. And you probably know, how many people know Ada Boost? Yeah, we got at least one third know Ada Boost. Ada Boost is a boosting algorithm. The general philosophy actually have the similar philosophy. This one is you treat objects gradually, you treat objects differently. Okay. Philosophically, you can think Ada Boost is doing the boosting in this way. Is initially, you probably do not know which object is more important when you build this classification model. But once you construct a classification model, you do the testing. Okay. Once you do the testing, you find some objects are misclassified. Okay. Once you find this object misclassified, you put more weights on this misclassified objects. The object clearly correctly classified, you put less weight. Okay, then you redo the training. This is more like a student take exam. If you do the midterm exam, the professor return you back the paper. What do you see? Of course, you first see is the score. Okay, suppose you got 80. You say, where my score was gone? Okay, you look at it. You say, oh, this question answered wrong. Why it is wrong? So you actually the question you answer right, you probably do not pay attention anymore, but the question you answer wrong, you actually say why it is wrong, okay? You go back and forth with your classmates, find, oh, my thinking on this one, actually my understanding was not quite right, okay? Then you pay a lot of attention on this. Next time when you do the finer, you say, I won't make the same mistake because I learned from it. That's exactly, okay? That's the reason that you do Ada Boost is to put more weights on the misclassified example. Next round, you do better. Okay. So what about this? This philosophy carries similar spirit, but we do not do the misclassified. Of course, you can boost it as well. Okay. But here, we first do not study boost. We just study within this connected network. What about something at this iteration classified? You ranked higher weight, okay, highly ranked one. Then we put more weights on the highly ranked one. Then we do the classification again. You will see just by this minor tuning, you can boost the network-based classification algorithm. You can boost the accuracy, okay? The first philosophy using in GNet mine is, typed network, you can do knowledge propagation. You think about this, okay? Suppose at the very beginning you take, say, this is data mining, this is database. You want to classify the into two classes for your papers, authors, keywords, okay? Then you take this author, you say, I actually know this author is doing data mining, and this conference is data mining conferences, this paper is data mining papers, and I can label them. Actually, you don't need to label everything. You for example, you label a conference, the conference will somehow propagate down to the keywords and propagate down to the author as well, okay? And then they are going to propagate, for example, this term is somehow linked with this term because they quite often appear in the same, maybe in the same title or even in the same conference. But anyway, they are linked. And author and author could be linked because they author the same paper. So with this, all the different kinds of links, they start propagating, okay? So essentially, you can think this is why it's like a semi-supervised, because you do a little training on this thing, but there are lots of data not labeled. But with the links, you can start doing propagation, okay? Then things will change, okay? That's a GNetMind. The general philosophy is graph-based regularization framework. That's why I'm not going to give you the detail. If you want to look at this, there are lots of probabilistic graphic model. You probably learned this from some other professors. But general philosophy actually is we are thinking this network, it's a structured network, it's typed network because it's heterogeneous. Then we can do knowledge propagation from one node to the other using the different kinds of links and different distance of links. Okay, then you can turn this into a loop. So you actually can see this is basically the graph regularization, and you do this propagation, but I'm not going to get into this detail. But I'm going to get a little more the philosophy on this rank class, the general philosophy is this, okay. At the very beginning, you actually initialize, you probably just to say the class ranking just based on the label. You label, you put this one, say this one is a data mining paper, you put this label as data mining paper. The other one you don't know, you can initialize them randomly or you get them zero. Okay, that's the initialization. Then you, based on their links, that means every object within this class, if you look at the neighbor one you assume because of this link, this one, you get a close neighbor is someone closer to you, either authors or co-authors, or you could get into conferences, or something close linked. You base on this link, you base on this probability, you have different weights, you can propagate down to the neighbors, okay? Of course, the neighbors and neighbors are competing. If this guy got into database labor, this guy did get in data mining labor, you actually start rival each other, you start competing each other, okay? Then you based on this, what you do is you actually will emphasize those higher ranked ones. That means you put more weights there. Then you redo the classification. The philosophy is you once you set up labor, you redo the classification. And once you redo the classification, you get some adjusted rank. Then you go back and redo it again. You essentially, you're turning this one into a loop. This one is not a boosting, but it's kind of boosting, right? The only thing is we do not really using eta boost. If you really want to take this one and you put eta boost together, you probably can see we haven't tried it yet. Okay, you probably, likely you may even get an even better result. And finally, you based on the EM algorithm, you actually can get a posterior probability, then you are done, okay? But what we want to check is we want to check, we get a few quite influential algorithms using, we use the same four fears. Database, data mining, AI, and information retrieval, these four fears. And we use like these are the papers, these are the number of papers, number of conferences, number of authors, and number of terms, okay. Then the interesting thing is, we had another student who actually did the label using, really using some semi-automated, then get an expert check. Actually, all of these things are labeled. That means we label it. That means it, if you look at those 14,000 papers, label it is not easy, right? But actually the student, previous student did the work because she actually used some automated mechanism, you know, then use some expert to check it. Use a group of our lab mates, check it and see whether the labor is right and redo it. So finally, we actually labored all these people. Of course, remember, papers and authors, the labor actually is not quite pure. For example, some authors within these 4 fields, some people are doing both. Okay, so then you cannot labor very uniquely. Also the terms. But then we get these kind of links. We actually comparing 3 algorithms. One actually was learning with local and global consistency. This one is homogeneous version. That means they are thinking about a homogeneous network, but not really typed. These are just based on weighted vote or relational labor. This is network-only algorithm. These are 3 algorithms quite known. So you look at this result, it's quite interesting. Okay. These are the training sets, size of the training sets. We use, for example, the smartest one is this 8% is author percentage. We label author and paper. Okay. Remember, if you label conference, you need a much smaller number of labels because the conference usually, for example, you say triple AI, you just put triple AI as AI. You actually got lots of benefit. We try to avoid that. Otherwise, the people are saying it's kind of cheating because you take a top AI conference, top database conference, then probably it's done. A small number of labels. But we just label 0.1% of authors, 0.1% of papers. Actually, what's the effort you label it? It's not that much labeling if you think about 0.1%. Because 0.1% means 15 papers. And this is about 15 authors. That means you label 15 papers, 15 authors. So this is a database paper, this is an AI paper or something. It's small efforts, right? Of course, we tried in many different ways. Finally, we averaged them. And we found, actually, these several algorithms, the previous one was quite good algorithm, but if with so small number of labels, you cannot do too much. You actually can see, remember we have 4 fields. If you do 25%, it's random guess, right? So this actually is quite close to random guess if you think of this thing. But here you can see the G landmine rank class can get a pretty high accuracy. Okay, the power actually using the structure and using the knowledge of propagation and using the ranking, so you can get pretty high. Okay, and these 2 algorithms you can see consistently, no matter you look at classifications on authors, on papers, on conferences, these are constantly better. Okay, remember, okay, even you look at this, you probably say, why authors and papers may not be as good as conferences? Probably it's easy to explain because authors and papers usually not quite pure. For example, the author could be cross fields. Okay. Usually the conference cross fields, not that many. Okay. So of course there are, so it's hard to get 100%. But if you look at the ranking on the top, say these are the top conferences and top rank the terms, you probably see it's very telling. Okay. For example, you look at these are the top ranked conference on database, data mining, AI, and information retrieval. The quality is very high. Okay. If you look at the, for example, you look at say terms like IR, what are the key terms IR? Retrieval information, web search, text. So these are probably even expert can get the same thing. Right. So that's the key part. If you do just tiny little training, you actually can improve the quality. Okay, so that's quite interesting. So that's the second algorithm I was showing you is rank class. Okay, and the third algorithm is distinct. Okay, distinct means the object usually You get different names, they mean the same thing, the same name means different things. Actually, those things quite often happen in the real world. Okay. Actually, the interesting thing is people can easily recognize that different words means the same thing. For example, you say data mining, the other people say knowledge discovery from data. you may say, oh, these are means the same thing. Even people say, oh, machine learning, some people say it's close. So you actually got a pretty good feeding. But once you get the same name, they mean different things, things become more difficult. Okay. For example, if you go to allmusic.com, you want to, you know, download some songs. Okay. So if you type a keyword, say forgotten, just unfortunately, there are so many forgotten songs. Okay. So you probably see people probably really, really, you know, thinking about those, thinking about your old friends or old home. Anyway, you get 72 songs, 3 albums, it's got the same name. Okay. But way one is even more serious because you probably you know Chinese actually got to even 1.3 billion people, actually very small number of family names. They probably have 200 plus family names. So then you see the collision on this is very high. Okay. If you get a phone book, you just list a family name like Wang, you probably get it. And some people told me they probably at least 50 million Wangs in China, which could be true, you know, because this is one of the most popular family names. And then this Wei is also a very popular first name. Then get together actually become, you know, a real problem because you look at the authors, even we actually look at 14 is the people publish more than one paper. That means at least 2 or more papers will get this. So get a 14 different Wei Wangs, okay? And of course, that's a student. I have to go down to the website to look at every way you want to judge whether this is the same. And finally, found the 14s. Okay. So, but how can we judge this? Okay. Actually, when the student just showed me, I said, this is a tough question. You better forget it. He said, why? I just said, you know, I myself co author with 3 different way you want. So, and actually, it's on the same conference. Okay, so that's exactly, even for me, I have to think about which year and what's the title. I may remember me which way want I really collaborate. So then student went back, he drew a graph. He showed the graph, something like this. He showed it to me. He said, what you said is true, but if you look at the links, you look at it carefully, they're different, okay? So then I started looking at the links. You can see those, for this Wei Wang, okay, she actually is a professor in University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. Okay, and she got lots of papers. She got a PhD in UCLA. And you look at her paper, actually it's an interesting thing is the co-author relationship. The co-author actually is, this is like a Dick Mans was her PhD supervisor, Joan Young was her like a lab mate. They actually published many, many papers together, okay. Then look at the other Wei Wang, okay. Actually, this is interesting because yesterday I just sent the promotion letter for this Wei Wang. When the person sent me the letter on promotion, I was thinking, I just wrote a promotion letter. Actually, well, wrote a promotion letter for this Wei Wang. Actually, this is the other Wei Wang. Actually, came from Australia. They sent me a letter, a reference asking to write the letters. I never co-authored with this Wei Wang, but his advisor, Hong Jin Lu, was my classmate. So that's the reason I actually know him quite well. So he was co-author with people in Hong Kong and Australia quite a lot because he's teaching in Australia and graduating in Hong Kong. And, you know, this Wei Wang was my postdoc, actually is a professor now in Fudan University. And this Wei Wang, the interesting thing is the Wei Wang actually published the paper with Jian Pei, was my previous student, was actually his student in University of Buffalo. He was in University of Buffalo for a few years. So those are different people, but the co-author is different, okay. But that's the tricky thing is this, okay. The first thing is you cannot use names as distinguisher because they have the same name, okay. The second thing is you cannot even use conference as distinguisher because they publish in the same conference. But if you look at subtler things, is you look at the links on different objects. You do not even know which object is more important, but you look at what are the different objects, then you find for different things. For example, some people using keywords or using conference can be distinguished them very clearly. But some, you have to use subtle co-author relationships to distinguish them. But the most difficult thing is training. Because if you don't train it, you say, set K is 14. How do you know it's 14? How do you know there are 14 wave months inside? You have no way. For example, Philip Yu, he published probably 600 papers. And do you know there are 14 Philip Yu's or is only one? Okay, you do not even know. Actually, the interesting thing is that he actually got a PhD in Stanford, was doing distributed processing, later become a database person, later become a data mining person. He changed the field quite a few times with different co-authors. It's very, very hard actually to get the right partition. So the thing is, we do need some training. Without training, we just cannot do it. Okay, and how can we train it? So the difficult thing is this. You cannot use wave one to train wave one, right? Because that's obviously it's cheating. So what we are thinking is, we use the same bulky data sets. That means we take DBRP to train DBRP. Simply says, we know DBRP, some data actually reasonably clean. Okay. For example, we actually look at DBRP, we say how to do that is there are some, you know, very distinguished, very reasonably long distinguished last names. Okay. Those people are like Mike Stonebreaker. Even Mike is very popular, but Stonebreaker is not that popular, okay? I mean, his name is not that frequent. So to that extent, we take those as reasonably clean data set. We actually, the interesting thing is the student actually took he did not take a concrete name. He just do the statistics study. And like Johannes Gerk, actually this Gerk actually came to our campus to give a distinguished speaker speech. He's from Cornell. The first thing he talked when I introduced him as Johannes Gerk, he said, I'm pleased to see you pronounce my name right, because quite often the people came say Professor Gerke or Jerk or some, you know, people say something very different. He got really pretty angry. So he said, how could you pronounce my name wrong? That simply says it's not that popular, right? But anyway, we take those, you know, reasonably unambiguous example as a training set to study their links, the strengths of the links, the type of links. We learn those parameters. Okay, then we go back to others. We start chopping them. Okay, so I can show you a bunch of examples the student got. Okay, this is Xiaoxin Yin, now he's in Microsoft Research. What he showed me, this one, is the interesting thing is, I first should claim Joseph Hellerstein, if anybody knows him, he's a professor in UC Berkeley, but actually there are quite a few Joseph Hellerstein, at least the two well-known ones. One actually is IBM Research, one is in UC Berkeley. Okay, they're both productive authors, but fortunately they carry different middle initial, okay, so it's not hard. Actually, it's more like George W. Bush and George Bush, or George H.W. Bush. So you know these are two different presidents, right? But, okay, what we do is we took out the middle initial, we merged them, see whether our algorithm can distinguish them, okay? So finally, you probably see, even you look at Joe Hellerstein, we actually got anything we dare to claim it belongs to one rather than the other is 100%. But their recall is not 100%, simply says there are some paper we dare not even say which one it is. Okay, so that's the reason. But if you look at the wave one, you probably say among all these 14 wave ones is still not very ideal. We actually go down to the real data sets, we check the wave one. We found actually there are only for 14 wave ones, we actually our cluster generated 13 clusters. Okay. And for 13 clusters, there's only one guy missed, and this two paper was credited to this Fudan University. And actually, these 11 papers, we checked it. The problem belonged to my previous student, Jian Pei. Because he co-authored with all these three, okay, and on the same topic, same conferences. So that's exactly makes things even more difficult to chop up. And that's the reason. Actually, I just say for Philip Yu, for the same parameter, Philip Yu, we chop him into two. Okay, this is the same person. The reason is, one part he was really doing distributed computing with all different conference, different authors. And later he changed it to data mining. It's like what I said about bioinformatics and robotics. You probably partition chopped him into two as well. Right. So, but that's probably happens. But overall, it's not that bad. What about, we got a 5 minutes break, and then we can resume, because I think you want to stretch it. Okay, we got 5 minutes, then we can come back. Okay, thank you.